This is North Coast Perspectives. I'm James Faulk. What has seemed like an initial victory in the war on COVID, at least in the short term, has suddenly turned into a rout. Infection numbers in California, Arizona, Texas, and Florida have skyrocketed, pushing the national number higher than it's ever been. Only a few states continue to see their numbers decline. Several states who were initially spared are now suffering through their own outbreaks. Many state governments are reacting with care and increased precautions, while others remain steadfast in their commitment to keep their recently reopened economies at full throttle. At this hour, the daily new infection total for the U.S. is upward of 50,000, and the most vaunted minds in epidemiology predict that 100,000 cases per day is a likely scenario. The resurgence of the infection has forced Governor Gavin Newsom to reinstate various restrictions in a number of California counties. Humboldt this far has been spared the extended limitations, but health officials here are expressing real concern. We'll bring you their most recent statements shortly. So far, we've seen more than 130,000 people die from this disease, including four from Humboldt County alone. Importantly, the people infected aren't just the at-risk populations that were warned initially. In Arizona, for instance, the under 40 cohort has been hit hard, and officials now worry that the next stage of spread could involve those younger patients infecting older people, people who are way more likely to die. Experts across the country are sounding by now like a broken record. Wear your masks, keep your distance, don't let your guard down. They repeat themselves because still, despite the obvious dangers and apparent risk to all of us, some folks have conflated wearing masks with political oppression. We should respect everyone's freedom to live and die by their own sworn principles, but spreading a deadly disease out of spite and ignorance may just make someone a murderer. Now, the headlines. Out of concern that large gatherings enable the spread of coronavirus, Eureka City officials this week announced that the annual fireworks display and Old Town Festival will be canceled. According to a press release, Halverson Park will be closed for gatherings, and Waterfront Drive between L and R streets will be closed to through traffic. The Eureka Waterfront Trail, as well as the Samoa Bridge boat launch, will remain open. Families are permitted to do their own fireworks this year, but large gatherings remain prohibited. City officials recommend, however, that because of hot and dry conditions, people consider the following alternatives to fireworks. Light up the night with glow sticks. Have an outdoor movie night, make a statement with noisemakers, and have fun with red, white, and blue silly string. If you choose to celebrate fireworks this year, please make sure they are safe and sane legal fireworks from a permitted booth. Humboldt County Health Officer Teresa Frankovich said the rising cases of COVID across the state and nation are a direct result from people getting out more and coming into contact with more and more people. This offers us all a lesson that we need to learn, she said.
Most people in the county have been watching what's happening across the country and certainly in the state of California. There are clearly areas of the state that are experiencing really rapid growth, even exponential growth of this virus, which is what we've been talking about for quite a long time now. The idea that COVID can circulate in relatively small numbers, but as we bring people out and start to mix them together, that those numbers can increase and dramatically increase across the community. I think there are huge lessons to be learned here. And I think that one of my concerns is that people focus on just things like, for instance, interactions in bars, because of course the governor in those specific counties has recommended that bars close. Bars are certainly a place of risk. There's no question about that. But what I think is really important for people to recognize is that it is, our day-to-day behavior that is putting us at risk. It is people gathering between households. It's those networks of friends and neighbors. And after a long time of shelter in place, people want to socialize. And it starts to feel safe because they look like your neighbors, they're your friends, and it feels safe. And I think we just need to accept the fact that it is not safe. The more you mix with other households, the more virus is going to circulate, and it is going to compromise our ability to move forward. It's going to compromise our ability to be able to operate many of the things we want to do. So schools are really important for us to be able to have up and running in our community. I don't want that compromised. I want us to be able to keep businesses open, but frankly, we are going to have to walk things back if it doesn't change. And another big important piece of this is masking. It is absolutely essential going forward. It protects other people. It is not meant to protect you specifically, but if everyone is wearing them, it will protect you. And so I just, again, can't emphasize enough that this is our time of personal responsibility. Either we accept that this virus is a problem and has the potential to make a lot of us very sick, or we ignore it at our own peril.
Last week, the county pointed out that the local Hispanic population has been hit disproportionately hard by the coronavirus. Officials are doing their best to improve outreach to the sector of the population, including its modes and methods of communication.
We have seen a disproportionate number of cases in our Latino community, and that's the same as been seen across the state of California. And it is a big concern. I think the questioner points out certainly an important feature here, which is in a community where English may not be the first language, it's really challenging to make sure people have the information they need to make good decisions and to understand how to access, for instance, testing and services that they need. It's certainly been a target for our Joint Information Center in terms of trying to reach out in all kinds of avenues to get people that information in the language that's appropriate. And I'm hoping we're making headway in that respect. I think also as we deal with cases in our community, I think, as we do so, we have the chance to earn some credibility with all of our population in terms of how we handle cases and how we handle information. And I think that's valuable and helps to create relationship between public health and communities. In terms of our local cases and immigration, I'm not aware of anyone who has not sought care because of their immigration status.
Vital infrastructure projects for the North Coast were part of the Moving Forward Act passed by the U.S. House of Representatives this week. North Coast Rep. Jared Huffman said the bill seeks to create millions of jobs, take bold action on the climate crisis, and address disparities in urban, suburban, and rural communities across the country.
I thank the gentleman, and I am excited, Mr. Speaker, because the People's House is at work this month. I wish I had more than 1 minute to talk about it all. Police reform, equal justice, lowering health care costs, protecting renters and homeowners from eviction. That's just in the last few days. This morning, I joined Speaker Pelosi and Chair Kathy Castor and our select committee members to unveil a comprehensive climate action plan to save the planet and to build a more healthy, just, and resilient America. And now I have the honor of supporting Mr. DeFazio's HR 2. The T&I provisions in this bill are an historic investment in our nation's infrastructure that will strengthen our economy, improve safety, and cut gridlock and pollution. But there's so much more in this bill. I'm also proud of modernizing the Postal Service's clunky old fleet and electrifying it. I'm proud of encouraging responsible broadband deployment on or near public lands and building more resilient Western water infrastructure. Colleagues, after years of people in this body talking about infrastructure, we're finally doing it. I urge an aye vote and yield the balance of my time.
Items in the bill also include restoring coastal and marine habitat, creating additional block grants to help provide Native American housing, fighting wildfires through vegetation control, and cultivating clean energy sources. We sat down with Mary Ann Hansen of First 5 Humboldt this week to talk about the impact of COVID on young children and how her organization teamed up with Changing Tides Family Services to aid childcare providers with much needed supplies. Recent deliveries from the two organizations included masks, disinfectant, children's books, non-contact thermometers, and diapers.
First 5 Humboldt was able to partner with Changing Tides Family Services and funding and supplies provided by First 5 California. We've done two deliveries. Changing Tides is doing the deliveries to childcare providers, and we've had two deliveries of materials, PPE, so gloves and disinfectant and other materials like that. And then the second was a delivery of diapers and wipes and books that went out to childcare providers, and we're gearing up for a third delivery soon, which is really exciting. You know, quite a few childcare providers remained open during COVID, yeah. Which allowed essential workers to keep working. I know, you have children, lots of folks have children, pretty hard to work and work efficiently with your children at home, especially, and not possible if you can't work from home and you're working, in a grocery store or you know, myriad healthcare workers, et cetera. So really, really grateful. We're really grateful to have First Five California's help and changing tides to partner and be able to get some of those supplies out because childcare providers are often, we're not full either. And so they've really taken a hit in their business model. And as you know, they're already not paid very much. So it was important to us to provide some support.
Hansen said First Five also partnered with the Humboldt Area Foundation and Eureka Mayor Susan Seaman to offer financial support to child care facilities. Newly adopted health rules have impacted providers by limiting the number of children allowed at each facility, among other changes. These care workers are vital for the health of our community and its children, Hansen said.
It's coming out next week. It's our child care capacity program. And we were able to partner with Humboldt Area Foundation with some great support from Mayor Susan Seaman of Eureka. Yeah. She helped us reach out and chat with Humboldt Area Foundation. And we're going to provide up to a $750 incentive to childcare programs that either are open currently and have remained open during during shelter in place or open before October 1st. It's not a huge stipend. It's, you know, $500 if it's a single classroom program, $750 if it's multiple classroom. But we really recognize that childcare providers are really being squeezed pretty hard during this time. And social distancing is really hard to do if you're caring for a two-year-old, right, or an 18-month-old. Yeah. And so there's some, while they might be wearing masks, there's still some risk that they're being exposed to. And so really it's an appreciation as much as it is any kind of, you know, financial incentive. Yeah. So the press release is coming and the applications are coming out next week. Okay. And we're just super excited to be able to just acknowledge the really important work that childcare providers are doing. And I have to, you know, give a shout out to Humboldt Area Foundation because they've donated $55,000 from their COVID response fund, and First Five Humboldt is putting in $65,000 so that we can provide those stipends out to the community. And they liked the idea so much that they reached out to Del Norte County and Trinity County as well, recognizing the vulnerability of childcare.
Hansen's main concern surrounding children the age of COVID has to do with enforced isolation, stress, and the impacts of these on kids who may already be at risk. It's become more difficult for both parents and children to get the help they might need to mitigate bad situations, she said.
You know this, James, that social isolation is a risk factor for all sorts of negative health outcomes. And you understand about ACEs and toxic stress. And how you know, adults and good relationships with adults and community members are what buffer stress to keep it from becoming toxic. And I think our greatest worry is about the families who are isolated, who are isolated from their traditional supports, or are feeling like they don't have that social connection, so that they can be present enough to buffer that stress for their children. Because this is what a soup families are in, right? Their work situation has changed. Many of them have lost their jobs. Many of them are worried about their financial security, their food security. They're having children either at home or precarious childcare situations if they have to work outside the home. It's just a bad equation for increasing stress on children and parents. And so my biggest concern is that the isolation will contribute to making that stress toxic. Mm-hmm. And you know, that has outcomes on everyone's health. I would do what you can to connect. You know, connection doesn't have to be physical connection. You can have proximity distance, but still have emotional and social connection. And whether that's that Zoom or you know, walks along the beach where you're maintaining distance, but connecting with others, because really taking care of yourself as a parent is super, super important for your children.
Yeah.
So that you can, you know, buffer that stress.
Be back after this short message.
For 50 years.
There's so much in this world we can learn, no matter how young or how old we are.
The faces have changed.
Wasn't that terrific?
Bon appetit.
Unbelievable.
The places have changed.
I want them to love me.
The world has changed.
Landing a man on the moon before this decade is out.
What a wonderland we found.
But our vision stays the same.
Whoa. This is an incredible story.
What defines us is our minds and our hearts.
This is all possible because of physics.
Whoa! Yes!
It's really part of our mission to make sure communities across the country are safer.
Thank you.
I have chills.
What an amazing family.
The world keeps moving.
We're going further than we've ever gone before.
But our mission never wavers.
How about that?
Always seeking.
This is totally amazing.
What's next?
I was raised to believe, despite where I came from,
that I could literally be anything I wanted to be.
Stay curious.
This is North Coast Perspectives, and I'm James Faulk. I sat down with documentary film producer James Thebaut this week to talk about his new film, Beyond the Brink, California's Watershed, which is currently airing on Keat TV. Thebaut has long been a fan of the North Coast and said people up here need to be concerned about the health of California's water resources because all the systems are interconnected. What impacts one part of the state and country will inevitably impact all of us.
Well, first of all, I want to say that you happen to be in a part of the world that's one of my favorite parts of the world, in the North Coast, in Eureka, and that whole region. I almost went to Humboldt State at one point in my life. So it's God's country as far as I'm concerned. We talked about the climate change crises. I'm calling it the climate crises, because I think it's interconnected with the COVID-19. We've got to pay attention to what's happening. We've compromised the integrity of the global ecological system. And because of that, we're now paying the price. And that kind of opens the door for all kinds of ecological phenomena which are happening around the world. So we need to pay attention. And the fact that you're up in the North Coast in Eureka and that environment is interconnected with the entire watershed. So it may rain more wet weather, but it's still interconnected to the southern part of the watershed, which is drier. It's all part of an ecological system.
Thebaut said most of the climate issues facing humanity at the moment can be traced back to mismanagement. He pointed to California's recent struggles with wildfires as an example.
Because of the fire suppression policies, which were created years and years ago, it's an historical being. Nobody wanted fires, but fires are part of the ecological system. Mother Nature has a way of dealing with the forest, dealing with fires, and the total environment appreciates the fires. The wildlife appreciates the fires. It revitalizes it. And yet we went out of our way into stopping fires in general, and which is, I say, contrary to what the ecological system is functioning. And consequently, it's been a big, big problem. And so therefore, we've had more trees than we can possibly deal with. And now trees are dying. They're not getting enough water because the water can't go around, can't be shared. Beetles have attacked the trees. It would take a spark. This is up above Fresno. It would take a spark to to ignite a major fire, because and then add to the problem, trees are cut. Some of the dead trees are cut down. They don't take them out of there, and there's debris related to these trees, and it's all over the ground, and it needs to be cleared. So we need to put on a full court press to deal with this, and it should be something. It should have been done yesterday.
One focus of his work has been the impact of climate change on food security, a consequence that alone has the power to make maintaining a just and equitable society much more difficult in the future.
Climate crises, their predictions of being so dry that there's not going to be, it's Middle East. These are even in the Southwest. I mean, the water in the Colorado hardly ever reaches the Sea of Cortez. It's also the same issues in China with the Yellow River. Watersheds all over the world are being affected by the climate crisis. So and watersheds are interconnected with food security. I mean, if we don't have the watershed, we wouldn't have the great agricultural system we have in California.
A longtime artistic tradition of Humboldt County has figured out a way to persevere in the era of social distancing. The 25th annual Friends of the Dunes Sand Sculpture Festival, scheduled for all of July, will take place among household groups and on social media to allow people to stay safe and still be creative. People are invited to hit the beach, any beach in Humboldt County, craft their masterpieces, submit pictures of those artworks, and then post photos on social media, where people can vote for their favorites and be entered to win special prizes. Quote, for the health and safety of participants and interested spectators, Friends of the Dunes is asking sand sculpting teams to practice physical distancing, which means teams should only consist of households or people that are sheltering together, unquote. Organizers said in a press release. Before households start sculpting, it is important to check the tides and always keep an eye out for dangerous sneaker waves. To enter, contestants should email images of their sculptures to info@friendsthedunes.org, along with the location of the sculpture, the date it was created, the team name, the name of the sculpture, and if applicable, the name of the business partner that your team is representing. We'll be right back after this break.
We care about the things that are going to affect the lives of each and every American.
What we normally see in these big crises, from the United States to Europe to China to Russia.
We can go deeper and get nuanced takes on things and allow people to see that everything isn't necessarily black or white.
For summer, for me, it's not a film. It's my life.
Summer.
It remains a fast-moving story. Climate change, healthcare, immigration.
To peel back the layers of the onion and to get to the heart of what really matters in every issue.
We're talking about very big dollars here.
It's guaranteed that the numbers of cases in coronavirus will be going up.
We're a place that people can come not just to find out what happened, but why it matters.
Eureka police this past Sunday were dispatched to the scene of a reported act of vandalism that turned out to be a lot more complicated. As dispatch was speaking to the original caller, it became clear that a serious confrontation was underway. At one point, someone shouted, "There's a gun." More officers were subsequently sent to the scene on 3rd Street, where they found the caller and Sean Thomas Avery, age 52, fighting outside Avery's apartment. Police arrested both men. A later interview revealed that while the original caller was on the phone with dispatch, he was trying to leave his apartment when Avery allegedly confronted him. Avery reportedly held a handgun and pushed the caller back into his apartment, where the two scuffled for several minutes. Avery ditched the phone, still connected to dispatch, so the man couldn't continue seeking help from law enforcement. During the melee, the gun went off and hit the floor next to the caller's head. The fight lasted several minutes until police arrived. A search of the apartment turned up body armor, an additional disassembled revolver, and more ammunition. Investigators later determined that the original act of vandalism to the caller's car was a bullet hole. Avery was later booked into the Humboldt County Correctional Facility on suspicion of assault with a deadly weapon, being a felon in possession of a firearm, kidnapping, being a felon in possession of body armor, negligent discharge of a firearm, obstructing the use of a device to summon emergency assistance, and assault and battery. Avery is being held on $75,000 bail. The Arcata Playhouse is doing what it can to help build community and support the arts during the COVID crisis through its Playhouse Wonder Wagon. The Wonder Wagon will bring arts to local elementary school and community center parking lots in Blue Lake, Fieldbrook, Valley West, Arcata, Cutton, and Eureka. Starting next week, free art packets will be offered to kids of all ages with materials for craft and dance. Supplies will be delivered to a number of locations, all of them outdoors. Check their website for more information. That's it for tonight. Thanks for joining us. For information on all things COVID, remember, as we always say, visit humboldtgov.org for stats and figures on local cases, fresh guidelines, and information on how to best weather this pandemic. They have a new dashboard at humboldtgov.org that breaks down by population and sectors of the economy and everything you could possibly think of, the COVID figures, so you get a real sense of who it's affecting and why. Remember to keep your distance, wear a mask, wash your hands, and stay healthy. Otherwise, as always, stay tuned, stay informed.